All right. So first of all, thank you so much for the invitation to come here. There's never a doubt in my mind when I saw the title and the whole idea behind this set of meetings that this was absolutely something that I should do. So I'm a physicist, I'm a toolmaker in this context, and I really hope that the kind of tools that we've developed can be used in this area. I mean, this is what we could always hope for all the applications. So let me say, since I'm new to this community, let me just say a little bit more about my background. So I'm a physicist, and I'm a computational physicist, so I work in statistical modeling. Most of it is what people now refer to as machine learning methods. I've been involved in brain imaging since the mid-90s. Actually, we worked the first 10 years of this interaction with human brain imaging. We were pushing the agenda that you really should get more out of your data than just what at that time was SPM, is sort of what we love, and also sort of our main target was to see if can you get more from the data than just, you know, univariate local measurements. So we argued you should use multivariate measures, machine learning methods. Of course, this was a very uphill battle in the beginning. The first 5 years or so, we were left for small conferences and so on, but later on, of course, we're able to sort of get those tools into the mainstream, and they are now very popular for understanding fMRI. Actually, we started in PET, so I know there's going to be a discussion about PET also today. So we started mind reading in PET, which is very torture, as you can imagine, to analyze. We had very small databases. But after sort of working about 10 years on other people's data, we started to realize that we really want to not only push what you can infer from those data, but also push what you can measure. We have to get more involved in the data acquisition ourselves. And this meant that we had to start looking at how can you get more data to train your machine learning algorithms. And I think the obvious tool is not PET, it's not fMRI actually either, but it is EEG. And EEG has this tremendous potential that I hope that I can convince you about today. There's a lot of problems. Also, let me just say that right away, it's a very sensitive measure. So it kills you also with all kinds of artifacts. And what we really want to establish is this pipeline connecting sort of the traditional neuroscience measures with full coverage, controlled conditions, with something like this, where you don't see the measurement device, so you can use it in your daily life. I'm going to, at the end, going to show you a couple of examples, and one of them is the really sort of the culmination of this. So this is not the published data, it's just analyzing the data at the moment, which is, as a teaser, an experiment involving implanted electrodes. And this is for normal adults, and this particular subject I'm going to show some examples from has been scanned continuously for 45 days. I think this is just showing the potential of those techniques. But let me show you how we get there with EEG. So, having been traveling from Europe, I mean, this is a question that I worry about. and this also proves my point, that if I ask you, how did you sleep last night? The real answer, I don't know, right? So, this is the quantitative kind of measure that you can get from EEG. If you have electrodes mounted on the subject sleeping, you can understand that there are these different phases of sleep, and some of them are very active in the sense that your mind is very active, your body is inactive, others are vice versa, and there are even wake periods during sleep also that we cannot remember afterwards because they were too short to consolidate any kind of memory. So this is just one example. In reality, we have very limited insight, quantitative insight, in what is going on in our own brains. I mean, although we have this fantastic first-person view of it, it's very indirect and qualitative, I would argue. And one purpose of this meeting, I think, is to get people into a more active mode about their brain, right? I mean, so that they can manipulate it, whatever that means. Others can help manipulate brains, is probably the right word. But I want to move this also into all kinds of other services, for healthy controls. And I'm not alone in this field. I mean, there are big businesses at the moment trying to move the same agenda, so I'll talk a little bit about that. So you could say that this is the working hypothesis, is that these in the wild brain monitoring systems can really make a change not only patients, but also healthy control line. So here's a sort of the outline. So it's kind of a sampler, so I'll be very superficial. Most of what I'm talking about is just going to show you some images or pictures. And of course, we have the whole day, so we can definitely talk about details if there's an interest later on. So let me ask you a little bit why this is important. I'm not even sure that's necessary, but I'll choose that anyway. And I'll show you three devices that we use currently and are working on, making sure that they measure the right thing and also see how much we can infer from the kind of data that we get. And then I have these examples. One is with the imaging device that we call the smartphone brain scanner. And the two of the devices sort of at the end of the pipeline, the ear EEG, and the other one is this implant that's subcutaneous electrodes from a Danish company called HypoSafe that we're very close to with. Let me see if I can show you this video. So this is again just a teaser that worked just a moment ago. So this is a YouTube video that we created on the smartphone brain scanner when we first made it in 2011. So here's what it does. It shows you in real time kind of rendering of what goes on in your brain. It is based on a very shallow measurement. So this is based on this particular demonstration was the so-called emotive device, EPOC, from the company Emotive. And the idea is that you can run experiments in everyday life. So you can let the smartphone stimulate you with different types of measures. And of course, it's totally inexpensive. So the whole thing is like $1,000 or something, right? So we bought a lot of these. So we have made some social science type experiments also based on that platform. You can take a look at that video later. Let's get back to the main thing here. So this is one of the commercial interests in this. So in Denmark, we happen to be in the center of hearing aid design and research. So we have three major hearing aid companies located in a very short perimeter around the campus of DTU. One of them is Oticon, and in their commercials, they use, they go like this. So what they say is that their new hearing aid is artificially intelligent. So what it means is that it listens to the sound. And actually, these companies have been very early to adopt also machine learning methods. So already in the 90s, early 90s, they patented using an artificial neural network, deep learning device, as it's called nowadays, to understand the sound so that you can manipulate the differential amplification of the sound in different frequency bands so that if it's speech, you crank it up so that you can understand what's being said. If it's aesthetic, you know, like music, you have to be more careful to sound nice also. So they detect the sound environment and then they present that in the right way in your ear. So modern hearing aids can do that. But of course, there's one thing that they don't have, and that's feedback. So they don't know really if it works what they're doing. And this is the promise of EEG in the hearing aid, is that by having electrodes in the vicinity of the ear or inside the ear canal, you can actually measure, say, did the subject understand the speech? And this means that you can change the amplification or make experiments and so on in order to optimize it further. So there's a lot of interest in this area. Right now, we're not working with Oticon, we're working with their competitor, Videx. Same story, they have exactly the same idea, and they have the patents on the ear EEGs. That's why we tend to work with them at the moment. So what can we do outside helping folks with hearing problems? Of course, there are all these cognitive biases that we have. Our brains are really not adapted to modern life, right? So this is the list from Wikipedia. You see it's alphabetic and it goes on until Z. There's a lot of them, and each one of them has its own page. And many of them are simply things that the brain should do better. And this, of course, the greater view of all this is that if we know what it's doing, we can maybe help it better to succeed in the task. So what can we decode from EEG? So here's a couple of small excerpts from the book by William James. I'm sure you're all familiar with this book. And basically what he says is that our behavior is stereotypical. It's composed from habits. Of course, some of these habits are good and others are bad. And what we want to work with in this area. And this is the promise that we can decode those, right? We can sort of learn what is the alphabet of behavior, and then we can detect them, and then we can start to manipulate them. So in terms of the human flexibility and habits, there's a real before and after. And that moment was in February 2010, when Laszlo Bayabasi, who's actually one of the founders of this network science field, a few of you know him and also maybe this work, he showed that in terms of predicting one particular aspect of human life, namely where you are, so the human ability is what they're looking at, and they used one of our tools also, namely the smartphone, to understand where you are and see how predictable are your trajectories during the day. They observed a few things. So one of them is that there's a huge variability between subjects. You kind of know that, right? There's a huge variability between normal behaviors and, of course, for abnormal behavior, even worse. They phrased it in the sense that there's a power law in the amount of movement, for example. So some people, a lot of people move very little, and few move a lot during the day, so to say. Also, they said there's very little generalizability between subjects. So if you know a whole lot about how one person is moving, you cannot really use that very efficiently to predict how another subject is moving. So what you really need is a lot of information about the individual. So this is why I call this a science of the individual, is that we really need not to to understand sort of the broad population in order to predict the individual. We need to understand the individual to predict the individual. And I think that's a very deep insight, and this is why we need better measurements of the individual. And this is why we need, basically, to monitor the brain 24/7, if you want to predict it and want to help it also. I'm not going to go into details, they just say that we confirmed the results, so we are also doing a lot of smartphone experiments. Actually, we had some data when we received this paper. We immediately went back and reanalyzed the first data set we made ourselves a couple of years before, much richer in sensors, but also much smaller in size. So Bayabasi analyzed a huge cohort. I think it ended up being like 40,000 people. Yeah, very small cohort. But many more sensors. But we asked the same questions using the same method. Were our subjects also predictable? And sure they were. So just like Laszlo Bayabasi concluded that behavior is totally stereotypic, you predict it, typical ballpark is 90% of the time if you have 1 hour prediction horizon. We completely confirmed that. I even have some pictures here, so this is on the time. So this is sort of seconds, so it says 60, 300, an hour and so on. And it turns out that this predictability is actually highest at the order of about 4 minutes. We don't know what that time scale is, but this is where we are most stereotypical in our behaviors when it comes to measuring basically location and movement of the device. That's what we're measuring also. So this is what gives me a great hope that that we are predictable, meaning that we can actually learn from the individual. So we can learn how behaviors are, and then potentially we can change them. Here's a couple of the projects that we have been going. I'm not going to speak about all of them, of course. I'm going to speak a little bit about this classroom experiment. So one benefit of having this very inexpensive equipment, of course, is that you can multiply it. It's pretty hard to synchronize it also. And for this particular experiment I'm going to talk about, we needed to synchronize these devices so they measured EEG at the same time and actually wanted to see how they reacted to a common to viewing a video together, right? That's the target. But it can be done also with the smartphone. The brain scanner, we can line them up, and we have methods for synchronizing them so that we have, in this case, for 9 subjects, they're synchronized at the position of EEG, synchronized also with the video presentation. The system is being stress tested also at the moment. Brahma team from MGH is working on translating transferring technology to underdeveloped economies, in this case Bhutan. And so one of the things you can do with this relatively inexpensive equipment is to allow these regions to use EEG, for example, for measurement of epileptic seizures and so on. So she's doing that at the moment. And of course, this is putting a lot of stress on this as a measurement device. And she's writing papers about the liability and so on at the moment. There's a machine learning component also in this. I'm going to say a little of this, but just sort of what is the general idea? So the general idea is that we want to combine two different measures. So one is what you would call the macroscopic level. So this is the behavior of that whole subject. So we'll try to capture that with smartphones or maybe even controlled environments and so on, or videos, whatever. And this forms sort of like what we could call metadata for the sensed behavior. So this would be measurements like EEG and acceleration patterns and maybe ECG and so on, other types of physiological measures that we could get from a particular subject. And the whole thing should of course be combined in a probabilistic description, predictive, hopefully, so we can say what happens if you do certain interventions for this particular subject. So in this sense, I mean, we're trying to follow this credo here, but in the opposite, right? Just you said before, we are scientists, so we try to do things that are as hard as possible. And of course, this is almost impossible, so this is why we do it, right? So sometimes we try to promote this in a link between the lab versions of the equipment and the street level equipment. In this picture that we call the keyhole hypothesis. So the idea is very simple, that there's an open door condition, so you're watching a room, activities go on in that room, and you open the door, that's the lab condition, you can see what goes on. And then you close the door, and then you peek through the keyhole, and what can you see, right? This is much shallower device now, for example with the EEG, and the hope is that if we characterize all the events that go on in this particular subject, we can at least count them in the with the EEG and figure out how often do subjects suffer from specific malfunctioning or seizures, for example, and so on. Right? So this means that we have to combine all these devices, so we have to combine the whole thing in the smartphone, also the measures that we get from the smartphone itself and maybe social media and so on. So parts of these, many of these arrows we have already established. So we run the biggest smartphone acquisition experiment in the free world. And the free world means outside Apple and Google and Facebook. So we have about 1,000 phones that we gave to students. About 600 are active at the moment. Have been running for almost 2 years now. So we know a lot about how these students are behaving, and we have their social media activity and so on. So this is this particular arrow. For some subjects, we have been able to connect the smartphone with this subcutaneous electrodes. This is what we're doing right now. And of course, the link here has been established in the smartphone brain scanner. So hopefully, in a few years, I mean, we'll be able to make this sort of like a complete package that can be a measurement platform for everybody to use. I mean, that's one sort of goal. I'm saying we're not alone in this field, so we have a very inspiring collaborator also. In Oldenburg in Germany, Stefan Debener, who together with his postdoc, Martin de Vos, who's now in Oxford, helped us develop in this version here. So that's the so-called EmoCap. It's a half emotive system, half conventional cap system. And we open sourced the design of it, so there are videos that you can see how to assemble this from the parts. Basically, you take the emotive device, you take it apart, you take the salient components from it, mount them in a small box that sits in the back of this cap. You can mount it on the top also if you want something to sleep. And then from one system, you get 14 electrodes. And the electrodes, fortunately, of course, are the ones that come from the cap. So this sampling device is perfectly all right. So you get really good quality EEG from that type of measurement. And you can do a lot of things say experiment we do seated, so this is audio brain computer interface and so on, and Stephen has been very successful in showing that you get basically the same results even if you're walking as if you're sitting down, for example. Stephen is now promoting this device, which is not in the ear but outside the ear, partly because of the patterns that are in this field, the patent stuff that goes on in the ear. So he has this flexible rubber band that seems to be really promising also for basically the same purpose as we are, so it's kind of discreet also, maybe not in the same sense as it was in the air. This is a commercial device that sort of looks like an extended hearing aid that was produced by this Canadian consortium in connection with Martin. So here's our device, so here's our picture of the cat. This is the emotion that we took apart, and here are the two electrode locations. So you can see that the new locations are much more usual in the sense that they sit where you would like them to sit. So this emotion thing was designed for gaming, and this means that it's picking up a lot of signals that are not maybe brain signals. So that's why I made the modified version. The design of the whole smartphone system and so on is quite the two papers that came out in 2014. The whole system is open source, so you can, in principle, download it to your Android system. So in the second version, not the one that you see in the video, that's a Nokia platform, but in the version that we run now, it's for general Androids. So pretty clear. Yeah, we cannot do this for iOS, unfortunately. But, this is the Android. There are some of the specs of the system. So it runs a Bayesian, so this is a machine learning type inversion algorithm. I'll say a little bit more about the inversion problem in a moment. That creates the picture in a cortical surface that has been triangulated into a 1,000 points, so it's relatively high resolution. Of course, if you have only 14 meshes and you want to say something about 1,000 variables, you have to use a lot of machine learning, and that's what I call a Bayesian here, to constrain that it doesn't go havoc just in overfitting and so on. So it runs in two time cycles. There's a short 40 frames per second imaging part, so this is for a fixed model that just presents what is going on in the brain. So in order to create that model, we need to know something about the noise, and the noise is not stationary. So every 10 seconds in the background of the other process, we compute the noise level, and then we recompute the model, and then we make an inversion based on that for the next 10 seconds. Right? So two simple timescales that nested in order to create the picture that we saw before. And it's been tested in all the conventional EEG settings and performed. Say a little bit more about the imaging. So why would we do imaging? That's very tortuous, it's very complicated, so why would we do something like this? And I think already we heard a little bit today in the wonderful talk that there's a need for knowing the networks, right, in the brain. Of course, networks come from imaging. So if you want to ever do something like community detection, understanding the graphical structure of covariance and so on, we need to do something like this. And there's a little bit of work in real-time connectivity analysis coming from the SWAT Center in San Diego. Tim Mullen has a few papers where he shows you can actually do that also in real time. So ours is not based on connectivity. We simply present the activation, and from that you can infer connectivity if you want to. So this is the forward problem. You measure something at the surface in K, say 14 locations, and then you want to say something about N, that's 1,000 locations in the brain. Fortunately, this is a linear relation. So to very high accuracy, this is a linear combination of meshes. So this is why we can have a hope to invert it. The inversion process is not linear because we need to add a lot of a priori information in order for this to work. So we have to say that not all locations are equally probable, especially if we know that some are active, then most likely another one is not active. So this is what we call sparsity assumption, and this is where the nonlinearity comes. A few other sort of things that we can do in order to improve on the quality of the spatial maps that we produce. So one is to use context priors. So in principle, from the smartphone, we know sort of pretty much what subjects are doing. From previous studies in the lab with the same subject, we may have sort of like an alphabet of typical states. Now those we can use in order to inform. So this is like what we call meta-analysis. So we have a lot of work on meta-analysis using brain imaging databases to help inform from a specific task what are the local localities in the brain that are most likely involved and so on. So those priors are always in the three-dimensional domain, not in the surface domain, meaning that we have to go to the 3D imaging in order to be able to use that information for understanding what goes on. And then there's even evidence that if you want to do something as simple as just decoding, that also works better in 3D than in the original surface. And this sounds like counterintuitive because it's basically a linear relation between the two. But the reason, most likely reason, is that in the process of reconstructing the sources, we eliminate non-brains part of the signal. So it's a cleaner signal that we then submit to the decoding algorithms. And there was just recent work by Ben Heath in Minneapolis showing that this can have pretty dramatic effects if you use that kind of 3D information. I have some students that just reproduce this for a different type of signal also, so I think this is pretty solid that it really does work better as a decoding device if you do that three-dimensional inversion. It's a big step. there's an example of how sort of detailed in time and space you can get signals. So here we are looking at imagined finger tapping. So a subject is sitting there trying to following a cue to imagine moving one or the other hand. So we integrate the signal in the hand area using this kind of spatial information about where things are in the brain. And then we get these two curves. This is what we call alpha desynchronization, meaning that the hand areas in the brain are relaxed from inhibition of getting access to or can process information. So there's this decrease in the amount of, say, 10 hertz power. Red curve is this emotive system, and the modified emotive systems, and the more conventional lab system is the blue. So you can see they're very similar. So the signal we get from an integrated area like the hand area is pretty solid, I would say, and has the same quality as if we had usual lab equipment. So here's the first of the examples. So this is using, as I said before, the smartphone brain scanner as a measurement device that uses the spatial dimension in order to decode engagement, attention, we would like to think of. And this is very much inspired by collaborators that we have in New York, worked by Lucas Perra and Jacek Spolsky. So they have these two papers, one from 12 and one from 14. Let me say a little bit about this from 14. This was a paper where they showed that the signal that you get from looking at synchronized activation in people watching the same video. So in Lucas' experiment, they have one normal control looking at a video, then the next, and the next, and the next, but they have very accurate timing relative to the video, what was the EEG signal. And now they ask, are there any commonality in the responses between a cohort, let's say, of 40 people? And there is, even at the sample level, there's correlation in the EEG signal. It's very surprising when you first hear it, and I'm sure this will be a discussion a little bit later. Is it really true? It is. So the EEG signal is actually correlated at the sample level. And this correlation you can only see if you have a couple of subjects or more. So here we had 9 at the same time. So now since we have 9 subjects here, this is for the publication, this is why we blanked out the eyes. So now the EEG signal is acquired, synchronized in real time. So this means that I can have access to this joint attention component in real time now, because I measure the 9 people, not consecutively, but as a joint synchronized experiment. And this signal is highly indicative of the engagement in the video. So using the protocol is that you show the video, and then you show the same video, but in scrambled order. So this means that you take the individual cuts and then reorder them, permute them, basically, show that to another cohort, then this engagement signal drops, goes away, basically. And the engagement signal is highly correlated with other measures of engagement. So in this curve here from the second of the papers from publication, he showed that if you do this with videos that have very broad exposure, say like a TV show, I think it was The Walking Dead, something, right? Then there's a lot of activation in the social media related to how engaged people are in this particular TV show. And for example, it drops like crazy when there's commercial content, right? And they can basically predict the signal from the brain signal. So Lucas is planning on taking this to Hollywood, right? And help them to understand why movies work. With our system, real-time acquisition, low resolution, sitting in this very messy condition, it's not nearly, it's not a lab, it's much more like the wild, right? We get very high correlation with this signal when we measure it in our subjects. With the one so we have the signal that Lucas and Jacek created. We simply can correlate at the sample-to-sample basis, and we have very high correlation. If you want to see the details of this, we put this preprint in the archive. It's in review at the moment. The confirmation that you can get the same, basically, with classroom condition. If we move on to another example, so this is the ear EEG device. So this little thing here is molded for your ear. So there's a device there that is very similar to the one that a musician would use in order to block out sound, right? So it's like a cast that fits perfectly to your ear. It's a soft silicone type. silicone, that's what we call it, silicone, with a few electrodes, and then you measure EEG in the ear. So if you think about anatomically, what is the situation for EEG signals trying to reach those electrodes, you would say, okay, this is pretty bad because we have the thick bottom of the skull that will probably insulate quite a bit from the EEG signal. But if you consider now that most of the noise that you have in EEG also comes from the brain, then it's not so strange that when you actually do this measurement, you find out that the signal to noise ratio is basically the same as if you measure on the surface. So the whole signal level is very low. It's barely so that the amplifiers can measure it. But if you have good amplifiers, then you can measure it, and it has comparable signal to noise. So now, what can you measure? That's the next interesting. Of course, it's close to the auditory area, so you would imagine that auditory responses are quite perfect, and they are. So we can get auditory sustained activity and auditory event rate activity that is very similar to what you get from surface electrodes. And even visual evoked responses, for example, are visible in these measurable in ear electrodes. And all of this has been compiled in this publication by the Kilmos, who is the one who developed this, first at Vibex and now at another university in Denmark, where they sort of sum up how well it works when you measure EEG in the ear. So I would say that it's pretty well established, and it's of course giving a lot of hope for hearing aid manufacturers that they can use EEG also. But I think also it's one of those devices that you would say is a real candidate for measuring long-term in the wild. So let me show you an experiment we did. So this was made in a hospital. So this was in a clinic that monitors for epileptic seizures. And the plot here is not so much measuring activity, but simply measuring how close is the correlation between scalp electrodes and the ear electrodes. What I want you to show is that this is really, so there's a high correlation. And this correlation is quite consistent through time. So note the time scale here. So these are hours, so these are up to 90 hours. And what happened here is simply that I predicted what would appear in the ear based on what you have on the scalp. And then that prediction seems to be really stable. So even if the subject is sleeping and sleeping on the ear and so on, the relation between what happens at the skull and the ear is very stable. We actually are able to predict the other way also. So we can predict from the ear electrodes what happens at the individual scalp electrodes. So there's some plots here. So this is using left ear, this is using decoupled both ears, and this is using coupled ears with a common reference. And if you really want to have good coverage, the best you can do, of course, is to reference them both. Then you get lateralization measures and so on also. And then we get pretty good correlation with electrodes that are close to the ear, of course, and also decent for the remaining part of the skull. Let me skip to the last part here. So this device is a device that originally was created in order to measure hypokalemia, so low blood sugar. When you are diabetic, you control your blood sugar with insulin, and of course if you over-control or eat too little, then the blood sugar can drop to low levels, and this is much more dangerous than what you're controlling for. You can spontaneously faint, and if it happens in your sleep, you can actually die from this, so it's something that you really want to avoid. It turns out that the brain is actually aware of low blood sugar level, even if you are not. So when the blood sugar goes to low levels, before reaching the critical level, there's a distress signal that's generated in the brain that emits signals that have low frequency and are quite easy to detect. So we helped this company more than 10 years ago to make the first sort of proof of concept where they detected those signals and found out that we had a window of about 15 minutes. So this device can read the mind of the user better than the user. Right, that's one thing. But it can also give you a warning, say you have to drink some juice or something to get your blood sugar up quickly. So this is what this company is working on, is to make a device for this purpose, and now it's in clinical trials. And I have some preliminary data from some experiments that are done that I just want to show you at the end here. So in this case, we had a normal healthy control with an implanted device. The implant was done, and then the device was in for 45 days. And at the same time, we had a smartphone in the pocket. Much of the time, we had a smartphone in the pocket, we should say. Right now, we're trying to find out how good the compliance was on the smartphone. But we had a lot of smartphone measurements, and we can see how the subject moves around and so on during the day. But here, I'm just showing you the data. So here's a spectrogram. So on the vertical here, I have frequency, you can see from 0 to 50 hertz. So this signal is originally measured in the kind of high frequency, and I downsampled it to 100 hertz in order for this analysis. So there are 50 hertz cap here on the content. And you see 10 hertz, very nice alpha power measurements here. And the first measure that we have done is simply to understand how is this alpha signal distributed throughout the day and weeks as time unfolds here. So this little plot here is showing the daytime measures. So for logistic reasons, the device is different in the day and the night, so here I'm only showing the daytime data. And the daytime are these bands here, so that this is midnight, and midnight down here, so you have during the day, we have these measures. And the red colored areas are periods where we have very high alpha. So I ran a simple machine learning algorithm trying to find out locations where there's a nice little peak in the power spectrum, indicating that there's alpha power present. And then I did that for 1 hour of the measurement, and then applied it to the other 45 days, simply asking how much alpha is there, looking at the components that were designated to be alpha. So there are two clusters, two different ways of seeing alpha. And then I simply measured how much of that was present during the 45 days. This is what you see here. So you can see that the darker colors are more prevalent. So this is the percentage of alpha being present during an hour. So every little box here is 1 hour. And you can see that it's roughly in the morning and to some extent in the evening. And you can see there's a non-stationarity. It seems like there's a lot of alpha in this week here. So we thought, what is going on here? And then we looked at the calendar. And this is the Danish autumn holiday. What we call potato holiday, because in the old days kids were going to the fields to pick potatoes. So clearly the subject enjoyed the holiday and had much more relaxation signal alpha present. And the same in the morning and so on in the evening. This is the accumulated over all 45 days, the distribution over days. And you were the first to see this. It's never been seen before by anybody. So let me close here by saying that that this is speaker's private thing. That I think this is extremely promising. I think this technology comes in different variability. There's the wearables where you can measure maybe for a couple of hours, but in realistic conditions. So say in a classroom, I think that's entirely possible. And of course, we're talking to a lot of people right now and actually moving into the real classroom and so on. And if there's interest in that, we'll certainly be happy to collaborate. And then there's the EEG that hits another segment. It's in the ear, meaning that it's less visible, but also it's a bit more painful to wear. It's not as stable as you would like for longer periods. And so you can see that there was some drop of predictability as the 90 hours progressed. And if you really want to have the full high quality signal in a wearable, I think the best is the best possible thing would be that implant. And now, is it feasible that people will get implants? Actually, yes. So we paid, of course, these volunteers to do it, but there was no shortage of volunteers there. So I think it's very easy to convince people to do it. It's something that is comparable to a piercing. It's done by a nurse. It's not a big thing. You close the wound immediately and so on. So I think it's feasible also as a research platform. And of course, the company is right now very focused on getting it to work for the population that they cater for in the first place, but are already now considering other applications of the same device. And I think if the pressure is high enough from communities like yours, then we could convince the company to build a research platform to do it. So I think that decoding the brain in real life is entirely possible. These are the devices that we are working on right now. There's a ton of super interesting things going on also in the engineering community across the globe. So I'm absolutely sure that this would be an instrument that we will see in real neuroscience experiments in the years to come. So we'll close by this comment. Thanks.